Hi guys, I'm Greg.
I'm John.
We're the Real Rejects, and today we're going to do another edition of How It Could Work. How It Could Work is our segment where we take potential or rumored or even in development sequel ideas, remakes, reboots, whatever.
And hypothetical stuff.
And we pretty much pitch our idea for how it could work. Today we're going to be doing Unbreakable 2. Since Split has been doing so well, box office, critical reception, we thought it would be a fun idea to do an M. Night Shyamalan movie, the one M. Night Shyamalan movie people have wanted a sequel to for many years, but because it didn't perform so well, I think over time it's gotten a pretty big cult following. I think people have really grown to really love it. He watched it for the first time last week. I watched it for the second time. I absolutely adore this film.
Yeah, I really liked it. I didn't know what to expect quite. I didn't know what kind of movie other than superhero something. Yeah, I think we both looked at each other like a half hour and we were like, this is really cool. Yeah. Like, this is really interesting.
And we were thinking like, is this even worth trying to come up with a sequel idea for it? Because the movie's so good that is it worth doing a sequel? Then after thinking for quite a long time, I think we found an idea that we think could actually really work.
I don't think this needs a sequel by any stretch of the imagination, but you could make one, and I think we've got a pretty good idea as to how.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And you guys might hear some background noise. It's pouring rain outside. Perfect day to do an Unbreakable 2 idea.
Yeah.
But let's hop into this. So if you guys haven't seen Unbreakable 1, there's going to be a lot of spoilers for you if you decide to sit through this. But basically in Unbreakable, there's a man named David Dunn, played by Bruce Willis. He has a son named Joseph. He has who's like 10 years old in the movie. He has a wife named Audrey, played by Robin Wright Penn. He basically is this guy he's a security guard in Philadelphia, and he's really depressed human being. He's really sad, really dour, and he survives this crazy train accident where pretty much everyone on the train dies. Hundreds of people die.
Yeah.
And he's the only one left alive, and he doesn't have a single scratch on him, leading to him being discovered by a man named Elijah, who is a dude who forgot the disease he specifically suffers from.
He basically has a deficiency that causes his bones to be very brittle, easy to break. Mm-hmm. They call him Glass Man because
Mr. Glass.
Mr. Glass, yeah. There you go, I'm sorry. Mr. Glass because of this. He is physically very weak, but mentally he is very
Sharp, very sharp, very bright, and he has an obsession with comic books. His whole career is based off of comic books and has a gallery dedicated to some like memorable art pieces and such. He visits Bruce Willis, and through a series, this whole adventure they go on is Elijah believes that Bruce Willis's character might have like, you know, some type of superpower, that he is unbreakable, literally. You can't cut this guy. He can heal from anything. He doesn't even really get damaged at all. And he has super strength. So as the movie progresses, David Dunn realizes he is unbreakable, decides to take on the role of a vigilante, but then it ends and he repairs his relationship with his wife because he gets in touch with himself, allowing him to connect with his wife and son. Yeah. His son knows who he really is. His wife doesn't. Elijah Samuel Jackson's character is kind of perceived as a little bit of a wacko by David Dunn's wife, and then we find out at the end, the M. Night Shyamalan twist ending that we're going to spoil for you guys if you haven't seen it, is that Elijah was the one who was responsible for the train accident, that he's been like causing a bunch of crazy accidents to occur in order to try to find some type of superhuman being out there.
Yeah, he's like a weird terrorist.
Yeah,
essentially,
exactly.
Who's looking for the one, you know, the one sole survivor of a catastrophe, you know.
So before we go into this, what we wanted to do with this story specifically is we wanted to keep it in the same tone, the same kind of style. One of the things we loved about the first Unbreakable was the way the movie was paced. It has a rather slow, taking its time pacing with it. It's also got a lot of multi-genre blends with it. It's like a family drama. It's a superhero origin movie. It's suspenseful. It's scary at times. And we wanted to keep all those alive while also honoring, you know, what the film does well, which is honoring, you know, comic book themes and formats. And then so where would this character go now that it's been about like 15 years since the original film?
Yeah, basically the stuff that we wanted to honor from the first movie is, you know, some of the visual tone and style, you know, the love for comics, and also just the character stuff, because there's a lot of interesting character moments in the first movie, and that's the stuff that surprised me the most. There are a lot of long scenes that play out. They're not your typical kinds of scenes for this movie. They're very character-based, and every single character has some kind of emotional growth or arc throughout. Approaching Unbreakable 2, we wanted to make it still a personal story, but, you know, expand on, you know, this version of the world, you know, where people with elevated abilities do exist and all that.
So as we go into this, we do have notes. We have over 25 pages of notes here.
We wrote a legit ass full-on treatment.
Yeah, we wanted to make sure that we really knew this story the inside and out. We have it all the way beat it out from beginning to end. So every once in a while, we might read directly from the notes just so we make sure we're communicating it clearly to you guys, as well as, you know, there's some moments that we have where we're like, well, let's come up with some dialogue so we can really clearly explain how this scene would progress. So every once in a while, we will read directly from the notes. But anyway, let's hop into this. Yeah. Unbreakable 2, How It Could Work. So the first movie starts off with a prologue. So we thought it'd be cool it with introducing a new character into this film. Let's start off with a prologue. This scene we like to call Little Girl Kills Mistress. There's a character that we're going to introduce into the film called Victoria. And Victoria, she becomes a very main essential character in the story. So this is a flashback to her.
The first scene we see her as a little girl. She's living in a boarding school and her parents are coming to pick her up because the headmistress has just been found dead after having some kind of meeting with this little girl. And the weird thing about it is that even though this situation looks fishy as hell, it appears that the headmistress is dead of her own doing. She basically beat herself to death with her own, you know, switch. So that's a nice little piece of intrigue to kick the story off.
And then what we imagine is that now after the prologue's been established, we hop into the setup that we like to call David's Confession. We imagine this takes place maybe like 10 years after the events of the first Unbreakable. Mm-hmm. So it's raining outside. David Dunn, he comes home into his new home and he's like exhausted. He's completely worn out and he's been missing for about 3 days. Audrey, his wife, who is now pregnant with her second child, hears him come in. David, he falls over. She drags him into the living room. And then what she does is she grabs herself on the call 911. But David says, no, he'll be fine. He just needs some time to rest and recuperate. He's worn out. Classic Bruce Willis stuff. Later on, David sits with her and he opens up about, you know, where he was and what he's been doing.
The double life he's been leading, yeah. Basically.
He opens up about the double life of being a hooded hero, explains that he's been tracking this group of gangsters. They got the drop on him tonight, and they took him hostage, and they even tortured him a little bit. So as David's confessing this, you know, tears begin to fill Audrey's eyes as, you know, questions begin to linger. And a moment later, you know, Audrey's horror is validated when David tells her he had no choice but to kill them. And he tries to hold it together. So David begins to cry. Audrey holds him, not sure what to think or feel. He can't quite tell which is worse anymore. The things that he sees, the things these men have done, the families these men have destroyed, the women who have been raped, the children that have been murdered, all that kind of stuff. Or the things he's felt in having to make the decision to ultimately end their lives. Like, when is it truly necessary to kill?
Yeah, he's got kind of an external conflict that's just as big as the internal conflict. It's like, this work is worthwhile, but it's also, you can't unsee and unfeel certain things that he's had to do, and that's a major struggle for him.
Exactly, and his concern is to always bring them to the police, but sometimes he has to defend himself. But there's like so much ugliness on top of more ugliness, just ugliness piling on top of each other. So he's starting to feel very sad and very empty inside, because you got to imagine that even though the first Unbreakable ends on a note like, oh, this guy's going to be a badass vigilante, the kind of things that they show his mind's being exposed to can overtake a human being who's not used to being exposed to things like that. We imagine that cool shot where like he's crying, Audrey's holding him, camera slowly pans back as we see like David curled up in Audrey's arms. And then we cut to 5 years later.
5 years later.
So we're officially 15 years after the events of the first Unbreakable.
At this point, their daughter, Anna, has grown up a little bit. She's 5, obviously. And now we see David past his life of crime fighting. He and Audrey are still connected. They're still trying to make their relationship work. But, you know, there's something off. There's a bit of a distance there. And so we see a scene where, like, David drops off his daughter. We find out that she's deaf. They speak in sign language. You know, a sweet little moment to show what his family life is like again, now that time has passed. He goes back to work at the stadium. He's worked his way up. He's dedicated his life to being normal. So he's the head of security there now.
Yeah, because if you remember from the first one, he was a security guard, but now he's the head of security.
Yeah, so basically we're just establishing, you know, like he is attempting again to commit to this life with his family.
Yeah, because one thing the first one does really well is establish his lifestyle. Mm-hmm. And that's so now we're seeing his lifestyle now. So in the next scene, we call Joseph Returns Home. Joseph was his son in the first movie that's 10 years old. So 15 years later, he's probably in his mid-20s at this point. So later on, David returns home to find his son, Joseph, and he's in the living room with, you know, Joseph's mom, David's wife, Audrey. They haven't seen each other in a very long time. There's a tension there. Joseph travels a lot and he shows up only occasionally, but this time it's the longest he's been away, and David is instantly moved to tears when he sees his son, who he hasn't seen in a very long time.
Yeah, so they catch up over dinner later on that night. The talk goes smooth, you know, it's nice that, like, they are happy to see each other again. It's only so long before some of the elephants in the room start to rear their heads.
Joseph never went off to school. He's been off traveling the world, he's collecting experiences, and what he's mainly doing is he's looking for others like his father, people with superhuman capabilities.
Yeah, this has become a fascination for him, and that is something that distresses Audrey and David quite a bit, and they worry that basically Elijah got into Joseph's head earlier on in life and that he's starting on that same fanatical path.
Yes.
They've seen how this can go wrong, and they're worried about it.
Elijah, just as a reminder, because I know we're saying a lot of names, Elijah, Samuel Jackson's character. Joseph, what he does is he basically defends the validity of Elijah's ideas, but he condemns his actions specifically. So Joseph, he credits himself in taking a more subtle, more careful approach to pretty much all the ways he's going about looking for other, you know, advanced human beings. Because the world has advanced a lot more since that initial train crash in the 2000 movie. The world's more connected more than ever by people and technology. He doesn't need to destroy anything or kill a bunch of people to discover, you know, who's another, you know, superhuman kind of being.
And he thinks that that's valuable work to do. You know, it's personal work for him.
But Joseph reveals why he's actually back home, like the real legit reason.
So basically there is a string of suicides that's unfolded, you know, around Arizona, and he believes that this is much bigger than a coincidence. Essentially, he believes that somebody like David with elevated abilities is responsible for all this. The killings all have a certain pattern, and what he's sort of been able to notice is that even though there's nothing that really links them, there's an uncanny kind of similarity between them, and it's hard to place exactly what it is, but he seems to think that, you know, this is something worth David's time to look into. Like, you know, this is your calling, dude, and you might literally be the only person who can stop this.
Because, like, these string of suicides, it's not like The Happening, by the way. I know that people might immediately connect that.
The trees!
Yeah.
Kill the trees!
These people, yeah, so these people are these, there's all these suicides happening, but it's hard to link, like, why are they all doing this? So David, he is compelled by this. Joseph, he believes that there's someone behind these suicides because there's one person who survived. We will temporarily call this person, this victim, named Luke. Luke was about to jump off a building, and then something happened where he either changed his mind or someone rescued him when he jumped. He explains that the reason he wanted to kill himself was because a woman came to him and told him to do it, that he should kill himself, but he's the only one who survived from the, you know, the all these incidences of suicides.
Basically, she convinced me I wanted to do it, and then for some reason I didn't.
Exactly.
You know, where everybody else did.
So even though David has been out of the game of, like, saving lives for a few years now, he's very compelled, but Audrey just can't entertain this idea.
Yeah.
You know, for David to risk his life like that again after all the traumas he's acquired over the years, after all the work they've done to save their life together, is just out of the question for Audrey. It's a flat-out deal-breaker. It's the end of them. So what David does, he weighs the options, but ultimately he turns Joseph down.
Yeah, which causes Joseph basically to finish dinner pretty quick and leave, you know, telling his father that he knows basically that he was more fulfilled when he was out there making a difference using his abilities. All Joseph ever wanted was to be like his father, so finding people like them is the closest thing he can get to helping and making a difference and being any kind of hero in the world, because David's not doing it anymore.
Yeah, and he really feels that, like, David just lost his sense of purpose. That's the whole point of the first Unbreakable movie, is that he finds his purpose in life, and now he's denying it, you know, because he feels that it's not good for him anymore.
Yeah, and part of Joseph's argument, too, is, like, for searching out these people, and also for bringing this new case to David, is because David's kind of alone in the world, and, you know, you see his depression in the first movie. If he can find more people like him, maybe he will feel a little less alone,
exactly,
a little less isolated.
You know, but David still sticks to his decision, and he watches his son go. So, in the next scene, we call Audrey and David talk before bed. So, later on, Audrey tucks their daughter, Anna, into bed. Audrey and David are laying in bed together. The lamp is still on, but there's clearly a noticeable space between them.
Yeah.
You know, we imagine that moment where, like, Audrey lays on her side. She's studying the folds in the sheets over David's midriff as David stares off into space. But then, finally, Audrey breaks the silence, and she basically lays out, if Joseph is correct and someone is controlling people's minds, she wonders, How does Joseph know that David would be able to stop this woman? What if she just mind controlled him into killing himself? David tells her not to worry about it, and they turn off the lights, smash to black.
Uh-oh. In the next scene, we flash back. We're gonna go to a different part of the story, so this is called a flashback to Victoria's past.
And the reason we're doing these flashbacks is because it's reminiscent of the first Unbreakable, when you saw like the flashback with Samuel Jackson's character being born in the first one, and then a flashback when he's a child a little bit later on discovers comics. So we're doing that with this new character. So please take it away.
So we see a guy named Dwayne, who's a bit of a hothead, but usually for a good reason, for a decent reason. He's unwinding from a long day of work at the local bar, and a dispute arises, as often happens. Three people arguing, and it's two men and a woman, and one of the men flat out smacks this woman, and he actually draws a little blood. And so Dwayne sees this, and you know, he thinks usually these are the types of things that sort themselves out, or a bouncer sorts themselves out or something, but he feels this urge, and he thinks back to a moment earlier in his day talking to somebody, a pertinent conversation, and he feels compelled to act. So he intervenes, and he grabs the guy who just smacked this woman by the shoulders, clocks him in the jaw, knocks him to the ground. Then the other guy, kind of when his mind catches up to everything, he grabs the bottle on the table next to him, smashes it. So Dwayne reacts quick to throw a punch, but the guy catches him with the bottle in the chest, ramming it all the way up into his throat in the heat of the moment. He starts to bleed, his jugular is severed. He basically begins to bleed out on the floor, and later on, an older version of the little girl we saw at the beginning of the story shows up, and it's revealed that this was her boyfriend, is the only person she kind of has ever actually attached herself to, and he's now dead. So this gives her, you know, a new struggle to chew upon, and something else to consider when she's taking her abilities outwards.
Yeah, will she act on revenge? What will she do at this point? So the next thing we call David watches the news. That night when David goes to sleep, he wakes up in the middle of the night, it's like 4 a.m. or something, and he goes to turn on the TV. He sees reports of a suicide bombing that took place in Arizona. And when Joseph was talking with them at dinner, he was saying all these suicides were taking place in Arizona.
Yeah.
But then what happens is Anna, their daughter, comes downstairs, and we imagine, we don't want to just excuse Anna out of story. So we imagine there's like a bonding moment when David brings her back to bed, has a little bit of dialogue with her, tucks her into bed, watches her go to sleep. But, you know, one of the great things I love about the first Unbreakable is those shots where it really relies on the actors to communicate without speaking.
Yeah,
so
totally.
Imagine one of those moments where you can see David watching his daughter, but he's contemplating a decision of whether or not he should go on this mission. Because after this suicide bombing, it's a lot of people's lives now who have died. Probably more than just the person who committed suicide. And you can see, he's looking at his daughter, the family he has, but he knows he has to make a choice.
Yeah.
So then we finally enter Act 2. Of course, here's where the plot kicks in. David accepts the mission.
So we cut back to David. He's back at the football stadium, doing his security work. And Joseph arrives, which seems tense at first until we actually realize that David asked him to come. He reached out, and David talks to him about how he's thinking of actually going out to Arizona and tracking this person down who's responsible for all this. But Audrey can't know about it. Again. This is too horrible to ignore. It's starting to take a toll on him, and David has actually started having nightmares about this situation, and they feel a little bit more than nightmares pretty much each time, and it's wearing him down. So he needs to know what he can do to take her down if Joseph has any information on that, which he doesn't, but he does know who might.
Ooh. So the next scene we have is David and Joseph visit Elijah, Samuel Jackson's character.
Back.
And at the end of the first movie, it's established that Elijah is now in prison. So David and Joseph together, father and son, visit Elijah. Elijah, and we kind of imagine him being sort of like a Hannibal Lecter from Silence of the Lambs type of character in this movie.
Yeah.
He reveals that Elijah has definitely heard about these suicides. It's a really popular story right now. He noticed the story in the news, and he does believe that this person is real as well. There's too much evidence for his mind to believe that, this is just coincidence that a bunch of people around the same city are committing suicide.
He's read between the lines, and he's picked out some of those uncanny similarities that nobody else can,
exactly,
with his high intellect.
So, of course, David, Clarice and Hannibal talk, David asks, what he can do to stop her. And Elijah says that from what he's worked out, it does seem like that some going off his comic book knowledge, that some invincible beings, they can shield themselves from mind control and telepathy. However, you know, it's hard to say. It's certainly not always the case if it is possible.
You can insert a joke about, like, wearing a funny hat made of metal or something.
Yeah, exactly.
Magneto hat.
And Elijah says, like, this person, like, this mind controller can easily stay in hiding. Mm-hmm. So somehow, David has to figure out a way to lure this mind controller out if he's to find her. So Elijah explains how if David can find the one surviving victim, David can tap into the victim's memories, because as we established in the first Unbreakable, he has, you know, a certain version of telepathy, not as strong as just reading a mind, but he can see stuff.
He can grab flashes from people's minds.
Exactly, and he can possibly gather traces of this mind controller.
So the next scene is called David Can't Lie. David's dropped off at home by Joseph. Audrey watches through the window. He doesn't know that she sees them, but, you know, mm-hmm. she's obviously spying this clandestine meeting. And over dinner later on, Audrey and Anna and David are all sitting around talking and stuff. And without revealing that she saw Joseph, Audrey confronts David, asks him just what he did today. He lies and says he went to work, and then follows up by saying that his mother's ill and he's gonna have to take a trip for a few days. At which point Audrey immediately calls bullshit and reveals that she saw him earlier today with his son, Anna, their daughter being intuitive already. She's pretty sharp. There's just like a small character thread. Like, their daughter is pretty sharp. She notices the tension, she grabs her food and she goes to the living room. And basically Audrey knows that David's planning to go to Arizona and to find this mind warper, which David says he has to. He's the only one, at least that he knows of, who can make a difference, and this has gotten out of hand. He can usually block these kinds of things out now. You know, he's learned that in adapting to family life, but this one keeps getting to him, and maybe that means something.
So a hurting Audrey, she reminds David of how he went missing for 3 days, that scene that we saw earlier, and when he came home, she was worried that he was going to die in her arms. And she believes David just can't handle more of this trauma, and nor can she handle the idea of the man she loves going out there risking his life.
And that situation before, at the beginning of the movie, like, that was just regular people, at least to our knowledge. So going out to fight another gifted...
Someone who can break the unbreakable.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's like, whoa! Like, this is a bad idea, David.
Yeah. So David apologizes to her because he is going to go on this quest. Yeah. So that night, as a typical husband and wife have a dispute, David sleeps on the couch.
Next scene, David heads to Arizona. Joseph drives David to the airport, and he wants to go along. He wants to help his dad. He always wants to help his dad. But David basically says, like, you gotta stay at home. You gotta keep an eye on your mom, your little sister, and if someone's gotta talk to Elijah, I need that to be you, if I need word from him. Joseph, he's put out by this, but he ultimately agrees because he is getting to help his father in some way. Maybe this can be a small step into rebuilding, you know, their closeness, their close relationship.
So in the next scene, David meets the victim. So early on into David arriving into Arizona, he visits the victim, who we're temporarily calling Luke, who tells David his story, you know, about how he saw this woman, she told him to commit suicide, and he was all about to do it, but then he didn't. A moment passes, and David basically does one of those moments where he's like, just trust me for a second. Victim nods, David grabs his hand, because David usually has to touch in order to feel a vision of the past. Mm-hmm. So what David sees of a vision of this character Luke, he sees a vision of Luke beating someone to death. And David pulls back, but he doesn't say anything. You know, he doesn't want to just go, whoa, what did I just see? Because he, you know, this guy can't just believe that, you know?
Yeah.
So, but David holds the victim's hand again, and then he sees her, the mind controller, a woman named Victoria. The one who we saw two flashbacks of. But then David decides to tell the victim of the crimes he knows Luke committed. Completely out in the open now, though, Luke confesses to David. Luke is talking about how he felt he should have just killed himself for the violence he committed. Like, it was more than just an order that he received to kill himself. He really felt that he deserved to die. And he felt a true feeling of despair and remorse. And the only thing he can remember is really feeling like the only way to have justice done for his crimes is to kill himself. And it was what he deserved. But something changed, and since that day, he's been a changed man, and he hasn't committed any more violent crimes.
What we wanted to do, just a sidebar, with the villain and the intrigue of this plot is to really play with what the mind control means. You know, we don't want it to just be like, I'm gonna tell you to do something, and you do it. It's sort of using the inside of somebody's mind, and that's sort of what that scene serves, is basically, it feels to him like it was his own decision, even though he knows he spoke to her. It's this very sort of strange mind confusion. You know, that's why it feels surreal, and that's why it's extra extraordinary that he saw his way out of it, basically. The next scene is called Bench Press. It's basically a whole montage, like Rocky IV, where David's just, like, pulling a log through the snow. No, Joseph's, he's sitting on the porch back at home. He's admiring the old bench press, like in the scene in the first movie where they're, you know, building
paint cans on the bench press. Yeah, and stuff, exactly. Yeah. But this bench press is like all rusty now and covered in leaves, like in the corner of their backyard. Yeah. But Joseph's on the porch.
So he's looking out at the bench press, and we notice that he's on the phone with David, sort of getting caught up on all the stuff that he's found talking to this victim, Luke. So he asks his father if he's going to report on this guy because he, you know, the things he saw in the vision. To which David says, you know, he believes that this guy basically had his death sentence and got out of it. He made some kind of change from within. And he personally, David, can't just go on, you know, physically punishing everybody. So if this man has truly changed, you know, he thinks that that's the best thing anyone can hope for. And this guy's already involved with the authorities, so he will be sorted out, you know, at least to the full extent of the law. Joseph wonders then if this is how the mind controller chooses her victims, basically. These are usually people who are involved in crime, who are shady in some way, but there's not really enough evidence. They're clean, you know, so there's not really enough evidence to convict them. And maybe that's who this woman is choosing to be her victims.
Yeah, she's serving her own form of justice.
Yeah.
So now we're at like the midpoint of the film that we call this scene, Meet Me at the Pool. Mm-hmm. So David arrives back at the hotel he's staying at in Arizona to find a note, like right when he opens the door, it's on the floor and it's obviously been slid under the door that says, Meet Me at the Pool. So what David does, he walks down to the pool to find Victoria. Now she's like 19 or 20 though, you know, because when we first saw her, she was a little bit younger, but she's still fairly young. She has like her pants rolled up from her, you know, at her shins because her feet are in the pool. But, you know, she's sitting on the side of the pool. Mm-hmm. So David like looks down at the water because the one thing that David can definitely die by is drowning.
Yeah.
So Victoria tells him not to be afraid and she won't force him to jump in. And David pulls up a chair. He sits across from her on the other side of the pool. So we imagine one of those like cool M. Night Shyamalan shots where it's like the pool's like green. And then, you know, like David's on one end sitting and she's on the other side sitting at the pool.
Wide shot.
Yeah, it's a wide shot.
Giant body of water.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
So David makes a remark about the pool being closed, to which Victoria responds, she spoke to the manager and it's a private event now.
Here we have a scene of dialogue. So Victoria tells David that they're very similar, even in powers. While David has a sense of telepathy, she can absorb and feel minds, sometimes from even miles away, sometimes. They don't even have to be inside of her to get the sense, necessarily. And if she can get close enough, she can influence and control them.
David asks why she didn't force Luke to kill himself after they saved him. To which Victoria says, you know, she saw something that's never happened before. He changed. David flat out asks why she didn't force Luke to kill himself after he decided not to. To which she says, like, that's something she's never seen before. She's never seen somebody change, and that moment did impact her in some way. When you show people what's really inside their minds and what they've become, you know, all the things that they've done sort of up front, they usually only come to one conclusion, and this time something changed.
You know, and David says that people change all the time, but Victoria, she denies this, pointing out that, you know, David's heroic adventure to find her and stop her, that David thought he changed, but look what he's doing now. He's on a mission to stop her. That David tried to deny who he was, knowing the crimes he himself committed and has been witness to, yet here he is talking with her.
She then reveals what Joseph has been suspecting all along, which is that the people she chooses are not, in fact, random. They are people who she feels deserve to die. They're all criminals of some degree.
Yeah, but David says that he only kills when it's the only option, but Victoria counters that with, it's all a matter of opinion. And then David asks, but why the suicide bomber then? If it's just like this one person, why'd you have a guy kill a bunch of people?
And for that, she basically says she needed to throw people off her trail, basically. Ever since, you know, the Hooded Knight of Philadelphia came to be, there are more and more little reports across the country of people with, you know, extraordinary abilities, and the suspicions of a potential mind controller have only gotten bigger because of that. So she needed a big event to kind of change the conversation.
Make it seem like it was maybe like some terrorist thing that was going on rather than like there's a person who could control minds. So David, he questions the innocent lives of those that died in that bombing though, which to which Victoria says that like attracts like, that environments contain the same kind of people. The bomber chose his own destination of where the bomb would explode, that she can see deeper into the souls than David can actually see, that there are cities where all these people truly want is just to die.
So after she says all this, David basically counters with, how do you know that's not just your own twisted view of humanity? How do you know all these people are so bleak? And she doesn't really have an answer for him. And to him, this is sort of proof that they are not the same.
So suddenly Victoria, she locks into David's eyes from across the pool. But then something comes over David. He tries to his best to resist this, but he can't somehow. Something confusing and scary is happening inside his head. And slowly, David, just full clothes and everything, slowly steps into the pool. He's terrified, but he makes his way slowly across the water, walking, making sure he doesn't go, you know, head underneath the water, crosses the water towards Victoria. As he slowly makes his way across the water to be in front of Victoria, we intercut with flashes of him drowning as a boy. They're like quick flashes.
Yeah, this is sort of a demonstration of power. She's using things in his mind to sort of influence him.
Exactly. And Victoria tells David that she can make anyone want to kill themselves. Even if you wouldn't normally want to, all it takes is finding the right thoughts and feelings to create one dreadful, all-consuming moment. She says, I know you better than you think I do. I don't have to touch your mind to know that you've thought about killing yourself.
And David, still in the pool, he's now like right up close. He's like face to face with her, you know, looking up a little bit. She continues, she says, you know, we all want to die sometimes. We all have that feeling. She holds her hand out to David, and David considers for a moment whether or not he should grab it, and then finally he does. He gets a glimpse into her past, you know, a more vivid, visceral glimpse than he normally gets. It's like a direct connection. He's not just seeing, he's also feeling some of this stuff. And so we enter a flashback that shows us basically the traumas of Victoria's youth. We kind of go back to the same timeline that the prologue took place on. We see her distant, neglectful parents. Like, it's a wealthy family, but there's not a lot of love there. You know, we see glimpses of her at boarding school, getting into fights and stuff, being isolated from her peers, you know, beratings from the headmistress. And we see the fit of rage in that, you know, meeting that ultimately caused the headmistress to kill herself. We see little glimpses of that lead up. We flash forward to the argument she has with her parents once they've brought her home, shouting between three truly disconnected people, and we see her parents' suicides and the pain and realization that she may in fact have caused this. We see sort of the moments where she's really putting together that she caused these deaths, that there's something inside of her that she doesn't quite understand, but now she realizes is there.
Yeah, so we pull out of those flashbacks. And David can't help because he felt all this. He didn't just see it. He felt it through her perspective. And he, you know, tears up a little bit. Classic Bruce Willis. When Bruce Willis cries, I cry.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. When Bruce Willis cries, you know he showed up to
In that moment, Victoria tells David she's not going to kill him. She says to him, now that I know how to choose, I don't take that lightly. David feels his self-control come back and he hurries out of the pool. She tells David that he's the only person like her she's ever met. She hopes they can be friends in some way. And Victoria leaves the pool.
The next scene is called Joseph Visits Elijah. So the next morning, Joseph is in the prison that Elijah's being held at, and he reveals to Elijah that this woman might be choosing victims that she believes deserves to die, you know, that suspicion. And Elijah extrapolates on just the general clash of morals. This is kind of a time for him to talk more about the nature of heroes and kind of mix in some of that comic book stuff. So especially when the gifted quarrel with the gifted, you know, there are huge repercussions that can lead to. One hero's definition of justice is different from another's, which often creates a considerable conflict between those two. The unstoppable force versus the immovable object and vice versa.
Yeah, so it's playing on like, you know how like the first Unbreakable played on origin tales? This is playing on like how, you know, Daredevil versus Punisher, Batman versus Superman, Captain America versus Iron Man. Sort of playing on that, but real Unbreakable style, you know?
Yeah.
So Elijah, he asks about Joseph and what caused him to become so dedicated to learning about superheroes. Like, Elijah says something along the lines of, your dad really inspires you, doesn't he? And Joseph reveals that Elijah was actually the inspiration for his mission. That Joseph loves his dad and wishes he could embrace himself and his abilities to the fullest, but that road until recently seemed pretty unlikely. That's part of why he left to travel so much.
Elijah then sort of muses to Joseph that maybe meeting this woman will be a good thing for David. After all, you know, he hung up the cape, so to speak, several years ago, and maybe meeting somebody like him is what he needs to find the next issue of his story, so to speak.
So Joseph speaks about how David just couldn't handle the visions anymore. He can tell how much David has been struggling with this, and he hates to see him broken by it. And Elijah speaks about the cross that heroes must bear. It's not all glory and pictures and papers and keys to the city. Part of saving the day involves truly being witness to the evil out there and taking part in it a way most other people don't or perhaps can't.
Next scene is called the food court. So it's morning. David is trying to fall asleep, and he just can't. His eyelids slowly roll down. You think he's almost gonna get it, and then there's a knock on the door.
And he's greeted by Victoria, who has two cups of coffee. Victoria tells David that she'd like to spend the day together, but it's his choice. So Victoria hands David a cup of coffee and walks away.
Yeah, and he thinks about it for a minute. You know, we're not sure. But then he shuts the door.
And then we cut to.
David is now in the car with Victoria. Victoria tells David that they're basically gonna go see what a day in her life is like, you know, the life that she lives. They go ultimately to a shopping center and they sit in the food court. They're talking, they're getting to know each other, and eventually she asks about David's marriage. And David basically gives a quick rundown of the situation, his marriage to Audrey and the strain it's gone through in the past and especially lately.
But Victoria, she makes a sly remark about how David just keeps giving up everything for her. Because in the first movie it's established that, like, David pretty much gave a football for Audrey, and now he's given up his life's work of being a vigilante for Audrey as well.
Yeah.
You know, but of course David defends the choice as his wife, claiming it as his own, that he couldn't handle it anymore, and yes, there is some truth in that.
Yeah, and that it's not just about her not wanting him to do it. He's also like, no, I also chose to give this up because it's kind of ruining my life.
Yeah, but you can feel David getting defensive, so Victoria remarks that David doesn't need to lie to her. She knows that David misses it, that he felt the fulfillment, and she believes that perhaps what David needs is another person to relate to, kind of like what her son wanted, to sort through the horrors with who can really share and bear that burden.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, she's hinting at herself at this point. You know?
Oh, yeah. And perhaps in this way, you know, he could still continue doing what he believes he must do, you know, embracing his power, using it for something. And she believes that while David and Audrey really do love each other, maybe they just don't fit together anymore. Maybe they're not on the same plane, and maybe their bond just can't endure this. And then the conversation continues flowing, and you know, they're on sort of a serious level, and eventually they broach the topic. Like, David asks if she could possibly do something to his mind to make him forget his abilities, or to take away his ability to use them, or basically to make him a normal person. So we have a little scene between them where she basically says, like, I can't take your gifts away. He counters by basically saying, like, you can tell me I don't have them, you can make me forget them altogether, like, who's gonna stop us? To which she responds that they're always with you, they're always a part of you, and sooner or later they're gonna come back up, you're gonna learn them again. And he's persistent, he just wants to forget, he wants to do this, he believes he can do it. And she counters, she says, like, you're not listening to me, this isn't gonna work. He says, you know, you can make me believe it will. He's basically desperate, he really wants her to try this. And eventually, you know, he gets so agitated that he kind of grabs her and shakes her, you know, demands this. And she shoves him off, you know, to buy a little distance, and then, you know, like, locks eyes and basically warns him. He says, like, you're not allowed to touch me. David takes a step or two closer, he hesitates. She tells him he doesn't want it, and he asks, how do I keep on? Life seems impossible. This is sort of the defining struggle for David in the movie. And then everything settles, you know, after a moment, they kind of calm down, and she basically says, you either decide to, or you don't. And if you don't, then there's something I can do to help you. And if it turns out that you do, I think I can point you in the right direction. But those are the either-onlys for how this all plays out. After which point, you know, she softens a little, and she identifies with him. She says, you know how hard it gets. Because she's been there too. She eventually kind of settled down once. That's the guy we saw in the flashback. It's like the one guy she was able to connect to, kind of start a life with. She says, you know, some days I miss hanging it up. You know, I lying down for bed, kissing goodnight, getting to sweat the small stuff in life. But we're just not made for that. And David asks her, you know, like, what piece is there? How is this ever not going to be torture? And she doesn't know. She does know that, as of a few days ago, they're both a little less alone in the world, and that's worth paying attention to. She can tell how torn up he is by all this, but also look at us. You know, we're two people like us, which we never even thought could be possible, and we can actually sit down for a moment and talk about these things. And from there, she hypothesizes that David, and herself as well, have been trying to live in a world that just isn't meant for them, you know? There are new precedents. The rules weren't written with them in mind.
They're basically part of something new and great and powerful in the world, and so this is where new things start. On the ground, one by one, up from the muck, this is evolution. This is frail and beautiful, but scary as hell. She believes that, you know, you need somebody with whom you can dish these things out with. Everybody needs that, and that it's finally available for David. And she acknowledges, like, I felt how much you love your family. But David, they can't handle this. We can. So she's saying, family, they can't handle this life, but you and I together, we can handle this.
Again, the debate continues. David says, like, I can't build a life off of fighting and killing all the time, meddling in people's lives with advantages that I didn't even ask for. There's a sacrifice in every direction, and he can't see a version that works out into any kind of a life for him, except this one right now.
And she asks him, like, don't you think they hold you down, though? And David starts to cry, saying, they hold me together. Those two are the only link to the life I want to live. Without them, they make me everything. And then finally he changes the subject and asks what they're actually doing here. Because it's becoming all about David and his emotional shit.
Yeah,
and he's like, I just want to know what the fuck was really going
this
on.
This was not what we planned.
Yeah, I thought we were going to see your life, you know? So Victoria, she then acknowledges that everywhere they go, there is evil very much present. Even as they scan the shopping mall, noticing families, couples, friends bonding, she asks David to focus and see what he can pick up. David plays along, but he's not picking up anything. He hasn't really been honing in on his telepathic abilities as much as he used to. Then Victoria decides to show off her powers.
So she closes her eyes for a few seconds, like 15, 20 seconds, and then she opens them and looks across the room and immediately spots a man named Frank in his mid-40s. He's timid looking, you know, kind of unassuming, and he's walking out the mall with his children. And she says, there he is. There who is, David asks. Somebody who has no business being anywhere near two children. He asks, what did you see? And she just says, come on. And they follow this man, Frank, at a distance.
So the next scene, who is Frank? So Victoria and David, they're now on the road. They're tailing this Frank character on the road. Frank pulls off by an office building. He tells his kids to wait inside the car as he runs inside the building. And Victoria and David sit in their vehicle, observing from many yards away, clearly out of Frank's, you know, distance for him to even notice. So Victoria, she then tells David that Frank is a family man, a lawyer, and has an occasional penchant for kidnapping girls, prostitutes mostly, and forces them into sex just before killing them.
And then she tells him that tonight, when he goes home to sleep, he's gonna wake up in the middle of the night, break a piece of glass, and he's gonna slice his throat open. David's caught off guard by the severity of this and becomes conflicted and agitated. Giving Victoria's mental capabilities, David asks why she can't just break into his mind and change him into something better. And she basically replies that that's not how it works, you know? I can't change who you are, I can't give you a whole new mind, not at least without doing some significant damage. Everything she does is based on what's already inside of your head. She kind of taps David playfully on the forehead. You know, something that deep and that big of a weakness point, you know, is something that's gonna find its way back into your personality at some point, and you don't get this far by just being a little misguided.
So returning to the situation at hand, Victoria gives David a specific address and instructs him to start walking to whatever this address is. And she's gonna have a talk with Frank. So Victoria goes to leave the driver's seat, but David puts his hand on her. She looks back sharply and instructs him, go now. David, unable to resist, takes his hand off her, exits the vehicle, and begins walking to wherever the hell this destination is. As Victoria exits her car, she shouts to David, don't worry, they'll be safe. Talking about the girl that's kidnapped in the building that Frank's at.
Yeah, either that or his kid. Just basically like the innocence of whatever's happening right now will be okay.
Yeah. So Victoria makes her way to the office building. Then, you know, we have a scene where we, you know, got back to Elijah. We don't really know what, but, you know, in terms of structure and transitioning.
Yeah.
So scene with Elijah doing some Elijah shit, right?
Yeah. Doing cool Elijah stuff. And then after that, we see a scene called Saving Frank. You know, as day turns into evening, David's walking through an unassuming neighborhood, and he arrives at the small home that Victoria told him to go to, and he sees her truck basically sitting out on the street. He knows she's there, and he comes upon her pretty quick and tells her that he knows this must be Frank's home. David basically argues that Victoria shouldn't kill him, that they should report this to the police and let the police handle it. You know, where's the justice? You know, if we have to live with it, so should he. Maybe death is too easy.
So yeah, part of the process, Victoria explains to David, is that by accessing the vulnerable thoughts and memories they've buried, feelings they've blocked out, her victims' minds begin to consume themselves, and it's here that they first contemplate the thought of suicide, realizing the wrongs they've done, feeling the weight of them without filter. All these things in their head rise up and confront them, and they feel they deserve to die. I've never seen one overcome it, she says. Not until Luke, the victim that David visited.
Yeah, the jumper.
Even when the most potent parts of our mental connection wear off, they all still decide to do it. They can't live with themselves, and they know that they're alone.
Victoria tells David that basically her spell, you know, that most potent part of their mental connection when she's still kind of attached to him, that part is worn off of Frank. Usually she has her victims die much quicker, you know, enough time for the effects of the connection to still be working, you know, to ensure that it happens. But she presents David with a challenge, and if David can convince him not to do it, then he can take him in. David looks at her for a second, then back at the door. He decides to take a shot at it, so he goes up, you know, knocks, Frank answers. David's trying to be cool, but he's also kind of agitated, you know, so he insists that he has some information that he needs to speak with Frank about, but it's no use. Frank is pretty insistent that David leave. He's never seen this man before in his life.
So David lets out a sigh, but he forces his way inside, causing Frank's family to jump in panic. David throws caution to the wind and tells Frank that he knows what he's struggling with right now. He tells Frank that he knows Frank feels like killing himself, but it was all this girl playing tricks on his mind. He knows that this all comes off a bit crazy. Frank, though, turns to his family, then backs to David, and finally, Frank admits that he does indeed wish to kill himself.
And David tries to talk him down from this, but Frank insists that whoever this girl is, she made him realize all the evils that he's done and the fact that he's kind of beyond saving, and that he's a monster, and he can never atone for the evils that he's done. He looks and sounds at this moment completely different from the guy we saw before. You know, he kind of looks like a flesh and bone ghost at this point, like a dead man walking. And David moves to grab him, which triggers a vision, and now he can see, you know, all the things that Frank has done. After that, Frank just begins to bawl. You know, he just collapses on top of David.
So what David does is he tells Frank he's going to take him to the police. David tells Frank that killing himself would just be selfish and the easy way out of this horrible act he's committed, that if he turns himself in and really works at it, he can bring about some justice and try to learn a new way of living with himself. And that Frank can also help put to rest the people who've grieved over the girls he's abducted.
Yeah, and maybe, even if he can't ever really, you know, rehabilitate, he can at least show his kids, even despite all this terrible stuff, you can still try, you can still, you know, at least atone for the bad things that you've done. Yeah. It would be a more responsible example to set, even though they'll probably never speak to him again.
So Frank looks to his family, and they're clearly confused and horrified by all this. They're all standing stunned and huddled in a corner. David pulls up Frank, takes him out to the car, and loads him into Victoria's truck. He puts him in the passenger seat, Victoria sitting in the back seat now. And before David closes the passenger door, Frank talks about the look the family gave him. Frank acknowledges, like in despair, that he'll never see them again. David can't find any words, can't find a response, so he simply shuts the door.
Next scene is called Interrogation Room, and it takes place in an interrogation room. They arrive at the police station, and David guides Frank inside. Moments later, David's talking to a cop, making up some bullshit story about how he met Frank and got him to confess and all that. And so Frank is in the actual interrogation room, sort of freely and steadily airing out his crimes to this detective who's in there with him, going over all the details. And as time passes, Frank sort of becomes more dissociated, and eventually he just goes silent. He sits there sort of eerily still. His eyes are kind of sagging. You almost wonder if he's dead or something.
Yeah. So the detective, he snaps a couple times, calls Frank by name before crossing the table to give him a good tap. As the detective gets close, though, Frank kicks the detective's foot out from under him, and then he grabs the detective's gun out of the holster and points it right at the detective. Mm-hmm. Frank moves back along the wall, putting some distance between himself and the detective before turning the gun on himself. He puts the gun of the barrel in his mouth, and then bang, psh. And the commotion that ensues, we imagine one of those M. Night Shyamalan, like, everything's called silent. Everything's all silent. You know, like there's no audio, but there's a bunch of craziness
going
on. Maybe that
ringing sound.
Yeah, that ringing sound, exactly. So in the commotion that ensues, David rushes to the interrogation room, frantically looks through the window, and he sees what's left of Frank, along with the splatter that used to be Frank's head. This horror sinks into David's face.
Yeah, it seems like a cool opportunity to put in some of those horror elements, because some of the crime stuff in the first movie is actually, like, unsettling. So the next scene is called David Confronts Victoria. It's later, time's passed, the sun is rising, it's the next day. David enters the parking lot of the police station. He spent the night there.
Probably being interrogated and all that shit, yeah.
Yeah, and Victoria's truck is still in the lot, but there's no Victoria, so he gets in the car and drives off. He makes it back to the hotel, and he finds Victoria there sitting on his bed. He's none too pleased, so he slams the door. He begins to yell at her, and Victoria tells him to keep his voice down.
David's pissed. He's like, he did it anyway.
He did it anyway.
And she says, I told you, most of them don't see it any other way. And David acknowledges, like, yeah, what about these kids? What about the family he lived with? And she says, like, what are you suggesting? We just let them keep on living together? My dad, the maniac? David, losing hope, though, is still like, yeah. There's a different way. There has to be.
Yeah. Victoria asked David if he would have turned him into the police if he had found him first, you know, back in Philadelphia, back when he was still on his, you know, crime beat. And David says, of course. But Victoria then counters, asking how many people David killed that he could have easily reported to the police. And she's got him there, you know, because he knows that there have been times where he could have. He didn't have to kill.
Victoria, she acknowledges that she knows. David contemplates bringing in certain people, but she also knows his judgment sometimes can be very much skewed, especially if David has seen a, you know, particularly grim and detailed vision of their crimes. Sometimes David decides not to turn them into the police, but serve the death penalty himself. And this really begins to seep into David's soul, like realizing that sometimes he chooses to be the killer.
Yeah, and it forces to confront things that he thought were justified that maybe weren't entirely justified. And from there, Victoria sort of brings up how her spell had worn off by a few hours by the time Frank had killed himself. So it is, you know, by all accounts, at that point it was his choice. So either David kills him, or Frank simply kills himself, but either way, it ends the same.
You know, David says he wouldn't have killed Frank, but Victoria stands. She gets close to David and tells him, like, she's getting more soft-spoken now, and she's saying, like, it's okay. She knows the horrors David has seen and why he sometimes can't rightly agree to let them go on living. And in this moment, you see that David's beginning to identify with her. So Victoria asks him, if you had my powers, instead of having blood on your hands, wouldn't you just have them kill themselves? Most of them can never dig back out. David takes a moment, then says, if those are my two options, yes. So he's agreeing with her.
And then from there, Victoria tells David that, you know, his telepathic abilities might not be as strong as hers, but he does have other special gifts, and he shouldn't deny himself these powers. That the memories of all that he's seen will always be there and continue to grow, but it's the burden he must bear for the better good. It's the sacrifice for, you know, the better good.
And then she brings up the fucking stinger again. She then says, your wife may not understand, but I do. Because she's this whole time, she keeps saying, like, Audrey is pulling you away. So Victoria puts her hands on his face. David looks deep into her eyes. As she gets closer to her face, it's like they're about to kiss. David hesitates for a moment, because you can see he's tempted to kiss her right now. And he tells her, stop influencing my mind. But Victoria counters, saying that she's not controlling anything in this moment, that she's letting go.
Oh, shit.
So Victoria goes in for the kiss, and at the last second, David finds enough willpower to push her off and then pin her down. He, like, holds up a fist and saying, like, I said stop it, because he really, like...
Yeah, he doesn't believe that she's outside of his mind. Yeah, like,
he thinks, like, his desire to want to kiss her is her doing that to his mind, you know? He struggles for a moment. He's holding his fist up, but Victoria, you know, ready to get punched, says... Just let go and do it. That if David truly sees no good in her, sees her as a threat, an evil force in this world, that he should do what he's meant to and kill her. A moment passes as the two catch their breath. David lowers his arm.
And Victoria pulls David in and starts to make out with him.
For a hand job.
She gives a hand job. They do a dog. It's basically a Deadpool sex scene in the middle of Unbreakable 2. Is what we're going for.
No.
So Victoria, after a moment, you know, pulls David in. And they sort of passionately start to make out, and you can tell, you know, David's giving into the temptation. He's kind of into this, but he does push himself off of her, and he takes a moment, and then just begins to pack and grab his luggage. She asks where he's going, and he basically says he's going back home. He's not going to try to stop her anymore. She can do whatever she wants. He just needs to get away. She asks him if he's going home to continue, you know, fighting again, and he says he's just going home. She grabs him one more time, you know, she's only gonna hold you down. And David shakes her off and heads for the door.
And then she says, then why did you come here in the first place? She calls after him. David throws on his coat, heads out, slams the door behind him. Smash to black, next scene, David returns home.
So he opens the door to his home. The sun is just appearing on the horizon behind him as he shuts it. He steps inside, looks around, he sees the pictures, he remembers the people important to him. And slowly he makes his way upstairs. You know, he peeks inside Anna's room and watches her sleep for a moment. It's kind of a tender moment. She's very peaceful. And a gentle smile even comes across David's face. Like, he's happy to see her. He's happy for something dear. And then he makes his way into his and Audrey's bedroom. He takes his time. He steadies himself. You know, this is kind of tense for him. He opens the door slowly so as not to wake her up.
Yeah, she's laying on her side right now. David takes off his shoes, crawls into bed. He's laying on the side that Audrey's back is turned to. And Audrey, without turning over to see David, asks if he's okay. Like, she knows he's home. David says he's fine. Audrey asks if he did it, you know, implying that he go through with killing her. And David tells her no. Audrey sympathetically turns over, looks at David in a gentle way, and says, why not?
And he takes a moment. You know, he looks back at her and ultimately says, because she understands who I am. And Audrey kind of doesn't get this. David becomes increasingly anxious, almost defensive, as she questions him, and he starts to tell her that this woman wasn't what he expected her to be. She's lived a similar life. She understood him in a way that he didn't think was possible. She has elevated abilities, too. And he doesn't know what to do. He loves Audrey, he loves their family, and he...
All right, really quick, guys. The camera cut, and I realized there was a problem with the mic setting, so sorry for all that background hiss you guys were hearing earlier. But whatever, all right? We put a lot of work into this. Hopefully you stay till here.
Well, the good news is that the audio is about to get a lot better.
Yeah.
So, treat for you guys for staying. It's actually a gift if you stayed this long.
Now that we're close to the finale.
Yeah. Audrey doesn't quite understand, you know. She can't meet him halfway on this. And David becomes increasingly anxious, you know, almost defensive, as he tells his wife that the woman he met in Arizona isn't what he expected her to be. She's lived a similar life to his. She understood him in a way that he didn't think was possible. He doesn't know what to do about that. You know, he loves Audrey, he loves their family, but he also can't go on living like he's a totally different person from who he actually is.
Exactly. So Audrey, you know, she sits up troubled. She's at her wit's end too. And she loves him dearly, but she can't spend the rest of her life worried that he's going to disappear, or come across the wrong people, or unknowingly bring his family or their young daughter into real danger.
And David, you know, he kind of furiously stands up, he gets out of bed, he starts to yell at her about how he's sacrificed everything for her, you know, that it was because of Audrey that he didn't pursue his football career, you know, he gave up on his dreams, and it was because of Audrey that he gave up one of the significant things that brought his life purpose and that helped him for a while, you know, and he's broken his back to change for her, you know, to fit into their life, and it's still not working.
Audrey fires back that if he ever got caught, it would destroy her, Anna, and Joseph as well. Then we like cut to a shot where we see Anna, she's sleeping in bed, but due to her hearing, she, you know, it's muffled background noise of Audrey and Joseph, you know, her parents that are having a yellow match. It's all muffled. So then we come back to Audrey and David, where Audrey is defending herself on how someone could have come after him and the entire family as well.
And then David retorts, you know, that he kept her and the family safe for so many years with never a single threat being thrown their way, you know. He can keep them safe now.
So Audrey, she's now in tears, but she's still furious and says that David will never be happy, that football wouldn't have made him happy, that being this vigilante didn't make him happy, and now he's blaming her for everything. And she feels like this is out of his character, that this doesn't sound like himself. So it's all too much, though. Then suddenly David snaps and pins down Audrey and begins choking her to death. It's kind of like that. So, you know, as Audrey's like trying to fight back, David's grip is becoming too strong. Moments pass, Audrey's fighting back abilities weaken, the color begins to leave her face. Kind of reminiscent, you know, like in Inglourious Basterds, that scene with Christoph Waltz where he's choking that one woman to death, if you guys have seen the movie. So it looks like that's about to happen, but then suddenly, Joseph appears, half awake in his t-shirt and boxers, and he shoves his father off of his mom.
And then David just flat out punches Joseph in the face, and he knocks him to the floor. Audrey crawls over to the opposite side of the bed. She manages to pull open a drawer, and we see that there's a gun inside. David pulls her back from the drawer. He tosses the gun and tries to restrain her. And then, you know, from across the room, we hear that familiar click. The struggle stops, and David looks up to see that Joseph is pointing the gun at him once again.
So Joseph stares intently for a moment, then fires, shoots David in the chest, knocking him to the floor. And the gunshot immediately wakes Anna up and she starts to scream. Audrey gathers her strength quickly, runs out of the bedroom to pick up Anna. So the bullet didn't penetrate David because he is unbreakable, but he is definitely winded for the time being. Joseph moves to the other side of the bed, the gun still pointed at his dad. And we see in David's like POV, he's in a haze, it's a blurred vision. He's looking at the ceiling. He slowly turns his head over to see Audrey running down the hall carrying Anna, you know, running away from the bedroom. Mm-hmm. And as he slowly comes to, he sees Joseph pointing the gun at him, and David utters to Joseph that he doesn't know what just happened. Next scene.
Joseph lies. It's a little later at this point. The cops are interrogating Joseph about the gunshot and the screaming that had been reported by the neighbors, and Joseph makes up a lie about what happened, basically covering for his father. David kind of watches this from inside.
Yeah, we see off David's look like, this is what Audrey was worried about. Like, the trouble that David could bring by doing this. Like, David's now seeing his son lying to the cops for him. Mm-hmm. This is all because David, like, had some weird moment where he snapped, and he's trying to figure out what happened. So the next scene, as we're getting closer to our finale, Elijah receives a visit from David. This time, David is alone. So David alone visits Elijah. We're midway through their conversation as we hop into this. And so David's finishing telling Elijah what happened with him and his wife.
And Elijah believes that perhaps Victoria planted an idea in David's mind to kill his wife because Victoria might view Audrey as someone who's preventing David from being who he truly is. You know, maybe she's tampering in his affairs. Maybe she is, you know, sort of selfishly acting so that, basically to drive David closer to her, basically.
He says, like, she wants somebody to talk to just as much as you do. That's what Elijah tells David. And Elijah, he surmises that perhaps she practiced, you know, some sort of longer, more subtle play on David to actually cause this, because he had to go all the way from Arizona to Philadelphia in order for this action to happen.
Yeah, and, you know, David's made his mind up, but he doesn't know how to kill her because if he gets close enough, he knows that she can manipulate him, and that's not going to turn out so good.
So Elijah then asks David if he wants to continue being a hero. David says that all he wants is his family back. And Elijah asks, but at the cost of losing your destiny? Elijah leaves David with this: you can't live there, and you won't let yourself live here. Where are you going to go to, David Dunn? Fade to black as we enter our finale.
The Last Resort is the name of the next scene. David is back in Arizona. He's at the food court that Victoria took him to before, and she doesn't show up. She's not there. So David makes his way back to the car, and there he finds her. He levels with her. He says he knows he can't kill her, and he knows that he can probably never forgive her for what she almost made him do.
So David levels with her. He knows he can't kill her. And he also knows he can probably never forgive her for what she made him do, what she's taken from him and all of this. So Victoria explains to him that David isn't free as long as she's around, she being Audrey. David knows he can't have both, living out this so-called destiny as some sort of like Superman-like person and raising a family with a young child. However, he does have a plan.
So the next scene is called Audrey Meets Victoria. Later that evening, Audrey, who is staying with a friend now, is greeted by Victoria and David on the porch. After much, much reluctance from Audrey, she finally decides to step out and speak with them. And David basically tells Audrey who Victoria is, and she levels with Audrey about the circumstances of the situation and uncomfortably apologizes for what she kind of led David to doing, the idea she put in his head. And she assures Audrey that David, she knows, you know, she truly knows how much David loves her. And Audrey is beyond any of this at this point. You know, she barely knows how to process this information. That's when Victoria asks if she can show her something.
So with tears coming to his eyes, David assures Audrey she won't be harmed. Victoria then takes Audrey's hand in one side and David's in another side. Then she basically creates a link. She shows the memory of Victoria basically instructing David to kill his wife and flashes of what David has seen and done. So Audrey is in shock, though, at this point. Overwhelmed, not only by the images, but because of Victoria's powers, she was able to feel the memories of David, vivid through such a direct connection.
And that flash, that vision she has, I think would probably be kind of a mixture of things. You know, some of it is the difficult and the ugly and the heavy, but also some of it is, you know, how much he cares about his family. Basically giving sort of a little mental picture of David's inner emotional life.
A gray area, not just the black and white thinking, just a full color palette of all the shit, you know?
Just a window into his existence.
David tells Audrey that he knows he must continue doing this. He has to find what he's meant for in this world. He just wanted Audrey to understand him a little better so they're not so distant. David says, we'll give you some time to think. So the next scene, Audrey makes a decision.
The next morning, David comes downstairs in his own home, and he finds Audrey sitting at the kitchen table. He sits down with her, she holds his hand, and she begins to tear up. And she basically tells David that she understands who he is at least a little bit better now, and she knows what he's got to do, but that also means that they can no longer be a family. They can't be together. So Audrey lets go of David's hand, and she tells him that he can, of course, still see Anna, but they can't be married anymore. You know, he can't put them in direct danger. And David tells Audrey that he will always love her, and she responds in kind, saying that she'll always love him too.
So in this moment, that's where David and Audrey, like, they're not going to be together anymore. Because even though I thought Unbreakable had a beautiful ending and wrap up with the family, David Dunn's family, the one thing I saw that I was like, ooh, this could be a potential flaw that kind of stemmed this whole plot was how it ends with Audrey telling David, like, we can't ever speak to Elijah again. Mm-hmm. And because, like, no, that guy's nuts. And you see that David's going to live a lie. Like, Joseph knows who he is, but David's going to live a lie because he's not going to let Audrey know what he really is going to do. He's going to, you know, fight crime and stuff. This is all from the conclusion of him deciding, I still have to do this, and Audrey knowing I can't be a part of this and have a life with you if you're going to do this.
Next scene, what will David do now? Joseph and David speak with each other, at which point David explains their decision. That night, David returns to the subway station where he first began hunting criminals, and he raises his hands out to touch those around him.
The conclusion is David is going back into this world. Reminiscent of that famous scene where he has his hands out and he's touching people to pick up on who the criminals are. Smash to black. Looks like it's over, but it ain't.
Up, up, up.
This last scene, Joseph speaks with Elijah. So Elijah is sitting with Joseph in prison. Elijah's finishing up a manuscript depicting the events we've just seen play out. So it's kind of weird. And it's like the saga of David Dunn and the woman who can bend minds. Elijah says, a masterwork. There's just one thing.
You think it's too cartoony?
No, you just left out your side of the story. Joseph hesitates for a moment. Elijah says, I know you love your dad, and I know that you're scared, but someday they're all going to see this as a gift you helped deliver them with my help.
Joseph stares down at his shoes. We're not a family anymore. I know Dad's back out in the world and making a difference, but I don't think my mom could ever forgive me.
Elijah reminds Joseph that he was warned of the possibility of this outcome from the start. It's a chain reaction that can't be stopped. You can just help guide it along. You help put your father's destiny back on its course.
Elijah asks if Joseph knows where Victoria is, and Joseph tells Elijah the information that his father shared about her whereabouts.
In this scene, what we intend for people to learn from it is that Elijah and Joseph were working together from the very beginning, that it was kind of a plan, you know, that came to be where they decided, okay, there's this woman in Arizona who's possibly bending minds. What if, you know, you, Joseph, you go talk to your father, you can convince him to go find her, this can help bring him back and be in here, because...
And well, also, like, this is something that he should probably at least investigate, maybe put a stop to. Lots of people are dying.
Yeah, like, and because Elijah also is, he's in prison because he killed a lot of people just to find David.
Yeah.
Like, this whole purpose was to find the hero. He believes he exists so he could have... found that hero, and now that hero is not being a hero, so this is Elijah's next step to bring him out. So we really learned that Elijah was behind this from the very beginning.
Yeah.
What looked like Joseph was, I have an idea, we can talk to Elijah.
It's kind of in the backstory. I don't know how much of it you're gonna actually see, but sort of the purpose of this scene is to develop, like, you know, when Joseph goes off and sort of in the details of his own life, I think he does kind of keep in contact. Like, after a while, he gets curious and decides to keep in contact with Elijah at least a little bit here and there. This scene kind of expands upon the complex villainy of the character that is Elijah, like his nemesis. Like, yeah. The nature of Elijah is kind of complex because he does help David with certain things, you know, and they have, like, a connection, but his means are... questionable.
Yeah.
And this is another example of that.
And we think it would make sense for Joseph to feel like a little mentored by Elijah because Joseph, from the beginning, believed Elijah's words. If you watch the first Unbreakable, he's like, yeah, my dad's totally this guy, you know?
Yeah.
He was willing to shoot his dad when he was a kid just to prove that Elijah was right the whole time, you know?
Yeah, so it seems like it makes a little sense, especially if he does develop some kind of distance from his parents, that this might happen because he's the only other potential, like, figure, like a sort of authoritative figure that we know about for him.
And I also do like the ending that we came up with here because I think it's like a decent enough cliffhanger where it's not like, oh, we need to see a part three, kind of like the way that part one ends. Like, we don't need a sequel. We don't need an Unbreakable 2. We don't. But it ends in a way where, like, you could do an Unbreakable 2.
And
kind of like this, leaving room open for, like, what are Elijah and Joseph going to be doing together? And what's what other... And it leaves an opportunity open for more other super beings out there. And so, I don't know. Yeah. I think this is cool. Yeah. I think it's cool, yeah.
It's a chance to do another interesting villain, expand upon the sort of nature of these superpowered beings. I feel like every character... We tried to give every character an emotional arc of some kind, all the important characters. And imagine all of this through that scope of those, you know, those long shots and those interesting frames, lots of character moments, lots of body language.
And a lot of the themes of this is about choice,
you
know? Like, I feel like a lot of themes of the first one was about accepting yourself, and a lot of this is about choice and what sacrifices you're willing to make for those choices, which is also in tune with a lot of comic book themes as well.
We did a lot of work beating this out. We came up with a lot of ideas, a lot of backstory. It took us a long time to crack the direction, so especially just reading this back, there's a lot more on the page than I think you would hear, you know, in dialogue if we made this movie. Like, still imagine this movie has all this stuff kind of visually.
Exactly, because one thing I love about the first Unbreakable is that it's a high concept, but told in a subtle, smaller world.
Yeah.
And we wanted to keep it that way. Like, we have a mind bender in here and stuff, but we're still keeping it in a...
Because even David's super strength isn't just limitless. And that was kind of what was cool about the first one, too, is, like, it's a down-to-earth version of these powers. So especially, there are holes... Like, this is a kind of a first draft, so there, of course, are holes to fill in. But especially with, you know, this telepath... We thought, you know, what could be a cool way of bringing a different kind of super ability, riffing on something familiar, but also making it, you know, kind of real and making it based on the orchestration of thoughts and emotions and not just straight up like,
yoo! Yeah, and one of the problems I do see with this first draft, keep that in mind, is cooked up and we're not getting paid to do any of this shit. So
yeah,
keep that in mind. It's just us having this fun is and for sharing. Our yeah. Is that there really is no scenes that necessarily lead to like Joseph using his powers to be unbreakable. And that's something that is missing here. But it's like we couldn't find any moments that felt truly necessary to show his super strength times. It's more than just that, you know? And I didn't want to come up with like, oh, let's throw in some action sequence that seems unnecessary, you know?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, and I don't know. I feel like there's a more of a... The first one has a very physical, very body theme, you know, an underlying theme of the body and might, you know? Because you have, you know, Mr. Glass is fragile, physically fragile, but his mind is great, and David Dunn is physically formidable. And it's kind of a physical story, so we thought it would be cool for the second one to do a more
mind,
mental, emotional,
mental
story.
Strength.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
And make that the super thing. And then we're gonna close it all off with the song from The Bourne Identity. You know, just because like that's always cool to hear that siren sound. That like at the end.
All right, guys, what did you think of our Unbreakable 2 concept? Do you guys have a concept in mind? Why don't you put your synopsis down below?
We'd love to read it.
We'd love to read it. You don't have to pitch a whole fucking hour-long story, but, you know, like, you put down your idea below.
Log lines.
Log lines. Let's so give it a log lines. Yeah.
Or, like, a five sentences max. Yeah.
But, yeah, tell us what you thought of ours. Yeah. If you're new to the channel, you can subscribe today to The Real Rejects. Rejects indeed, because this story ain't going anywhere. John is Reason to Jerry on Twitter and Instagram. Cool. And social media manager of Facebook of The Real Rejects. And the social media manager of Blumhouse's social media. Blumhouse, who produced M. Night Shyamalan's Split.
Actually. Split! Go maybe, see that shit!
Maybe we can get a good word in. Just get M. Night Shyamalan out of the way.
Let's get M. Night Shyamalan on the show.
Us unknowns who don't really have directing experience direct this sort of
thing. Guys, trust us.
Trust
us. We can think good.
Work for AVP Requiem. We can do it here.